few more seats so we can get started. My name is Susan Tai. I'm the Elizabeth Atkins Curator of Asian Art at this museum. And on behalf of the Santa Barbara Museum of Art and our director, Larry Feinberg, whom you will hear his remarks later, and the Friends of Asian Art, I welcome you to tonight's program. And tonight's program is indeed a very, very special one. And we're most honored, of course, to be part of the UCSB week-long artist residency that brings three master artists from Japan, each representing a living tradition, the no drama, no theater, culinary arts, and the photography, documenting the rebuilding of Japan's most sacred shrines. And as you see here, the artists have a statement here. And we must thank our sponsor. It is the Felissimo Japan, and through their Kofuku Taishi Cultural Ambassador Program, that they brought these three artists to Santa Barbara, to UCSB, and consequently tonight. So I'd like to recognize the lady who represents Felissimo Japan, Ms. Higashi. We're most grateful for them having such a significant program to send the artists out to introduce Japanese cultures to the Western world. And then, of course, UCSB is the organizing institution of this event, and many departments are involved in the humanities and arts, including College of Creative Studies, Art History, Department of Drama and Dance and Religious Studies, and so forth, among others. But this is all led by the Department of East Asian Languages and Cultural Studies. So I do like to recognize David Marshall, the Michael Douglas Dean of Humanity and the Fine Arts, who's here with us. And I know, David, you're right there. Thank you. And also, Fabio Brambelli. I know you're looking at your notes, but who's the chairman of the Department of East Asian Studies and Cultural Studies. And he will be, the reason he's looking at the notes is because he'll be helping us introducing the one of the programs here as well. Last but not the least is Professor Catherine Saltzman Lee, and who is really the maestro of this project. She's the project director. She's the associate professor of Japanese drama and literature in the Department of East Asian Languages and Cultural Studies. And she is not foreign to our museum. This is not the first time we have collaborated on projects. Just a few years ago, in 2011, those of you who may remember that she's our consulting curator who helped us to put up an exhibition titled Presenting No Drama, Theater Prints of Tsukioka Kogyo, a late 19th and early 20th century artist of Japan. And we have a very fine collection of his last series on the No Drama. And just to honor the occasion today, we have put up a few of the prints again in the galleries, and many of you will see during the reception, as well as a very fine Japanese no robe. And according to Katayama-san, one of the artists, he thinks it is a much older robe as well. And very lastly, I have one more person, one more group of people in the community to thank is the Urasanke School of Tea Ceremony in Santa Barbara. At the very last minute, we enlisted their help for tonight's program. So my job is very easy, it's already done. Now I'm going to turn the microphone over to Professor Kate Saltzman Lee, and who will direct the rest of the evening. Professor Saltzman Lee, please.
Well, thank you, Susan, very much for all the introductions. It's really a pleasure to be here, and it's wonderful of all of you to come. I think we do have a very special evening. We have four remarkable people here to make presentations to us. They've come just for this. Mr. Masaruda, the photographer, and our two wonderful actors, Mr. Katayama, sitting right here, have come. They arrived Sunday night. They performed Monday at UCSB. They performed Tuesday at UCSB. And here they are tonight performing once again. So we're very, very lucky to have them. I should say Mr. Aoki is assisting Katayama Sensei, and you won't really see him until the reception. He's been just wonderful and wow. Masaruda Sensei has a magnificent exhibit at UCSB. I highly urge you all to go see his photographs, which he'll be talking about tonight, and you'll see images of them. But I can assure you that the images, digital or in print, look absolutely nothing like the real thing. We have a beautiful DVD to give you a feeling and to give you information and to take you through some of his experience, and it does it really, really well. But the images themselves, which are printed on Japanese paper and are really quite remarkable, black and white photos, are really worth the trip out to UCSB. The exhibit will hang through Thursday, possibly Friday, most likely, but not for sure. So if you definitely want to see it, get there by Thursday sometime. Oh yes, that's tomorrow, I'm so sorry. Well, it should be there at least Friday morning, I should say. Whether it'll be there all day Friday, that's not good. And last but definitely not least, Sugimoto Setsuko is here as a representative of a particular style of Kyoto cuisine, what we might call home-style cooking. But it represents not only the food that she'll be talking about, but really kind of the way of living that surrounds the food and what the food represents about how people have lived for many hundreds of years. And she shares this very personally, as you will learn, through her own family's experience, where they lived, and how they got carried on these traditions. So all together we have called this Master Artist from Japan Living Traditions. Obviously you can see that the actors and Sugimoto-sensei are the people that carry on these traditions. They themselves, if we didn't have them, we wouldn't have the traditions. If Katayama-sensei didn't spend his whole life training from early childhood, as you will see, we wouldn't have Noh. If Sugimoto-sensei didn't learn from her mother and spend hours doing all the things that are necessary to prepare meals and menus and keep these things going, they wouldn't exist anymore. So their bodies to us are precious because they carry this knowledge in their minds. In the case of Masaruda-sensei, the photographer, obviously photography is not an old art that's been carried down in this way, but he's done a very kind of amazing photo essay. He's a fine art photographer, and so with his eye, he's photographed these processes of renewal of the shrine. And he'll tell you about it, so I don't really need to say a lot about that now. But I should just say that just to get permission to do this was quite remarkable. It involves permission from the Imperial Household Agency. Many things are quite secret, and he had access to more things than most people who are not really part of it would ever have access to. So this is very, very special. I'd like to just say a quick thing in terms of acknowledgement. Again, you already have met Higashi Megumi-san, who represents the Fujisuma Corporation. And together with Akiko Taguchi of Kyoto University of Art and Design, they came up with this idea of bringing the artists together, these very disparate practices. And then we worked together to think about how to tie the various practices together. But it's thanks to Higashi-san and Taguchi-sensei that we are able to get this going. have these programs at UCSB. We have a very full week of things. I hope some of you have already been to see the actors and with the wonderful programs that they did this week. Unfortunately, if you didn't, you will not see them again after tonight because they're going home tomorrow, as is Masuda Sensei. However, you get really special things tonight, so don't be too worried about that. And Sugimoto Sensei just arrived yesterday. Everybody's on jet lag, yet they seem to do remarkably well. And she'll be doing two programs at UCSB, which she'll be talking about too. So we have a wonderful full week at UCSB, including the exhibit that hangs all week of the photographs. It's been really my pleasure to work with Susan Tai to pull this special event together. And to have all of them here for one event was actually Higashi-san's idea originally, because we were just going to have the actors. And then she began to think about how we might pull all this together, and we all put our thinking caps on, and here you are. All right, I would just like to now turn our attention to NO. And I'll just say a few things so that we're first going to be watching a DVD of Katayama Sensei. It's a very special DVD because what you're going to see first is his father acting. Then you're going to see him acting, including his first stage appearance and some of his other roles. And then you're going to see his 9-year-old son when he made his 3-year-old first appearance. The names may get a little confusing. An important thing to say is that actors and other traditional artists in Japan change their names over their career. A new name represents a certain level of attainment in their art. So Katayama Sensei, for example, took on his name on January 1st, 2011. He became Katayama Kuroemon the 10th. His father is Katayama Kuroemon the 9th and is a living national treasure in Japan. But he took on the name at the very beginning of 2011. Before that he had a different name. And this is true in all of the traditional arts in Japan. As you take on the new levels of attainment, you take on a new name. One special thing about the performance that he'll do at the end of tonight is it's one of these scenes from NO. It's considered something you only do when you have reached a certain level of attainment. So we get the fruit of all of his years of study and practice and training when we see him do Shakkyo tonight, the shishi, the lion dance from Shakkyo. Not just any actor can do that. You have to have worked hard and earned that place to do it. So don't be, the English will begin a little into the DVD. So just know that when you start, don't be too confused by the different name changes, but you'll start seeing his father, then him, and then his son. I was asked to say just a little bit about NO. I don't think I need to say too much because you'll see it, but, and I think many of you here know about NO. So only to say that essentially NO is performed on quite a bare stage. If we were on a real NO stage, we'd have a pine painted back here. We'd have a bridgeway, so-called bridgeway, a long extension of the stage going off that way, on which the actor would enter and exit. And we would have four musicians sitting right here, a flute player and 3 different kinds of drum players. We would have right here a chorus of actors. They're not just, you know, they don't train to be a chorus. They train, like Katayama Sensei, to be actors, and then they may take the role of chorus at a particular time. Very few props, and they're mostly symbolic of what they represent, and of course, masks, which are very critical. One last thing to say is that Katayama Sensei has trained during his life, as has Aoki Sensei, the other actor whom you'll meet upstairs, to be a shite actor. That means an actor of the primary role. I'm sorry? Oh, excuse me. An actor of the principal role in a play. So he specializes in those kinds of roles. Last thing to say, the play that he will perform for us at the end, you will be able to, you can read on the back that just a little bit that you need to know, but I think it will speak for itself. All right, so we're going to start with a DVD. that we've been prepared, as I said, about the Katayama family.
皆さん、改めまして、こんばんは。ありがとうございます。日本の京都からやってまいりました、能役者の片山九郎右衛門と申します。いささか舞台と勝手が違いまして、上がっております。どうぞ、皆さん、お力添えをよろしくお願いします。
Sensei has introduced himself, saying that he's an actor from Kyoto, and he's here, and just wishes him to go to Kyoto.
Today, 世代が継承継ぐことということにつきまして、お話を少しさせていただきたいと思います。
So he wants to speak to us tonight about passing down the art from one generation to another, what he likes to call generational succession.
私は17世紀終わり頃より続いております。京都の能役者の家に生まれました。
He says he was born in a Kyoto no family that has been in continuous work, I guess we could say, since the 17th, end of the 17th century.
能とは現在まで続いているものといたしましては、世界最古の舞台芸術でおよそ700年近くの歴史がございます。
So Noh has been a performing art form in continuous existence and practice for around 700 years.
笛、小鼓、大鼓、太鼓の4つの楽器による音楽を伴い、歌いという独特の歌唱と舞、語り、セリフによって人間の本質や情念などを描き出す、少し不思議な演技でございます。
It's a marvelous theatrical form in which human, kind of the essence of human beings and their feelings are described with the use of the flute, the three different kinds of differently sized drums, and this beautiful music that accompanies, as well as the chanting and the dance and the narration and finally the dialogue, which are all specially characteristic of Noh.
また多くの舞台芸術がその不便さゆえにメイクへと移行する中で、能面という専用の仮面を使うことを今でも貫いておりますことも特徴的でございます。
So whereas other performing arts, you know, use makeup and other ways of creating the character, Noh has masks that are just for Noh. So masks that are called Noh masks are a specialty of this art form.
武士、つまり侍に好まれ、そのたしなみとして江戸時代より明治維新までは式学として武士のセレモニーには必ずというほど催されました。
So the samurai class, according to its taste, held ceremonies where with ceremonial music, and this was from the Edo period until the very beginning of the modern period, the Meiji Restoration.
さて、本日お話しさせていただきますのは世代継承、継ぐということでございます。
What he'd like to talk about today in particular is this handing down of the art through the generations.
日本の古典芸能に携わる人間にとって継ぐというテーマは少し重いテーマに聞こえるかもしれません。
So in traditional Japanese arts, the idea of the handing down, we could say succession, is very important.
しかし、平たく言えば、幼き子を持った父親の悪戦苦闘でございます。
But it starts with a tough struggle for the parents of the child.
今、 私は9歳の息子やアマチュアの方も含め子供さんたちの脳の稽古をつけさせていただいております。
So he's engaged now in training his 9-year-old son, the one that we saw do his first performance at 3 years old. He's engaged in training him together with amateur performers.
いや、それにしても近頃の子供はとても忙しいなと思います。私の子供の頃よりも教育がハイレベルになっていることや遊びの種類も仕方も随分様変わりして多様化していることもあり時間ばかり取られているような気がいたします。
He's telling us that for today's children, they're very, very busy. And compared to when he grew up, school is at a much higher level of expectations. And there's many more ways to spend your time, your free time. In this sense, time is used in very different ways.
昔のように学校帰りの子供を捕まえては稽古で絞るというような、親の流れ作業ではできません。ここが辛いところです。
So he's saying when he was young, when school was over, he would come home and we could say was seized even, was grabbed, was forced to practice. Very, very tough.
勢い、予定時間内にものを覚えさせることのみを目的とした稽古になりかねません。しかしそれではいけないと子供に何とか頭で覚えるんではなく体全体で染み渡るような稽古を心がけています。
So it's a kind of very vigorous program of learning, and he sees that today's children wouldn't have trouble memorizing and learning, yet the idea of Noah is not just to memorize things but to take it in with your body.
日常の何でもない仕草が後々舞台の上での品格に関わるからと心を砕いています。
And it's really difficult to get the body to where it can have a kind of stage grace, we might say.
私の父などに言わせますと、なんでそんな面倒くさい教え方をするのや。自然と子供はついてくるやろ。毎日稽古場に来させたらいいやろ。もっといろんな舞台を経験させろ。お前の頃はもっと舞台数があったよ。と申します。
You probably could get the sense of that. It was definitely a complaint. He says that that his father has said to him, and then the rest of this is what his father has said. Why such a, you know, annoying teaching method? Go with the regular way. He should come every day to practice. Give him lots of stage experience. You spent much more time on the stage when you were young.
すると私は心の中で死に向かってそれができたら苦労はないやと少々悪態をつくのですが、
he thought to himself, thinking what he'd like to say to his father in response to that, about how hard that is on a child.
息子も稽古が嫌いな方ではないと思います。むしろ勉強より好きというのが本音でございまして、物心つかぬ頃よりしているせいか、かなりシリアスな切迫した状況の稽古でも今のところついてくるな、まあよしと私は思っておりましたが、知らんは父親ばかりで脳の忙しい5月に舞台が重なった時に母親にもう舞台はつけないでほしいと泣いて訴えていたそうです。難しいことだなと本当に思いました。
He's talking about the difficulty of practice what it means to a child. He says that he doesn't think that his son minds the practice. He, in any case, prefers it to studying. He says that in his feeling that too much pressure is not a good thing. And he talks about May, the fifth month, May, is a very busy time for no actors. And his son went to his mother and said, crying and pleading to say, could I just not go on the stage right now? So this is a little thing that struck him. And it's really, it's a very difficult kind of thing.
私にしますと、年齢に応じた脳の舞台経験を全てさせてやり、将来に備えさせてやりたい。しかし、脳も現代を生きる芸能としてあろうとする限り、あんまりいっぱい社会とかけ離れた脳しか知らないアホな人間になってもらっては困るとも思い、
So he says that he would like to have a full life in No, but of course it's, you know, and to have guard what he does in No throughout his life, but it's a complicated life and it's difficult. He says if we want No to continue to be a vibrant art, we can't as actors just separate ourselves from every day with the idea that, life is just about No. So again, he's getting into this idea of what it means to become an actor and what sacrifices you make and whether they're good sacrifices for the sake of the art.
子供はそんな悩みを持つ親たちをよそに、ある時は舞台が大好きと言い、またある時は嫌いやと申します。
So when his son is asked if he likes acting by people outside the family, he sometimes says, oh, I love it. And at other times he says, ugh, I don't like it at all.
子供にときましては、どちらも本当の思いでしょう。モザイクのように心のあちこちに好きと嫌いという思いが隣り合わせになっているんだと思います。では、私はこの後一体何をしたらいいのか。
So he says, which one is true? The like loving it or the not loving it? And he says that he thinks that they're joined together. There are going to be times when you do and times when you don't. But he says, you know, for him it's still a question of how to deal with it.
やはり時としてなだめすかし、叱り飛ばし、また励まして、子供の心の中の好きという気持ちをつないでやるしかないなと思います。
He says sometimes he tries to coax his son, sometimes he scolds him, sometimes he says, you know, make more of an effort, that kind of thing. He says, but he thinks that the most important is that you somehow have to connect.With what it is that he likes and what he's doing.
中にはそんなことせずに自分の子供に無理に継がせずとも初めから好きな子だけを集めて稽古すればよいのではないかというお考えの方もいらっしゃると思います。しかしそれでは脳そのものがジャンルとして弱くなってしまう。
So there are those who think it's not worth the struggle and who just teach those who want to be taught. But he doesn't think this is a good idea. It will weaken the art.
子供ながらにいろんな挫折も経験し、我慢の上に初めて気づいたそれでも好きがどうしても必要なんです。
Childhood is full of frustration.And it's necessary to begin to build patience.
脳はとてもしんどい芸能です。体力的にも精神的にも、ここまでが芸を作るためのいわば 基礎編でございます。
So he says that no is a difficult art, and both physically and mentally. And these are his thoughts about passing down the art. He wants to talk about something a little different now.
ここから先こそ能役者への本当の修行の道です。
And this will be the actual practice of a no actor.
劉宗世阿弥650年の記念の年に最も思い起こさなければいけない言葉は初心忘るべからずという一語だと思います。
This being the 650th anniversary of Zayami, he thinks the most important words of Zayami, I should just pause and say Zayami was perhaps we could call him the founder of No as it is today, but he goes back to the late 14th and early 15th centuries. He and his father were the first to bring No to what it is, and he's also known for many works that he wrote about No and about practice in No. So Katayama Sensei says that to him the most important words of Zayami are the words that are translated as something like, don't forget your first heart. Don't forget your first feelings. Don't forget how you felt at the beginning, you might say.
そしてこの言葉は、詰まるところ、世代継承の知恵。心から心へ伝える花を次へ受け渡すために最も大切な教えなんです。
So I think this is the most important teaching that there is.And that it very much encapsulates this whole concept of handing down the art. He calls it the wisdom of the successional, of the generational succession, and believes that the kind of flower of performance is can be passed down. That's the teaching of this particular line.
まず真っ当に修行を重ねた能役者がようやく世間にちょっといいなと言われ始めた頃のことです。若さゆえにありがちな自信過剰または思い込みゆえの未熟さを初心と言い、その失敗と恥ずかしさを忘れてしまってはその後の上達はないと戒めています。
So when an actor is young, he has a kind of excess of confidence and other things, and the quote is also warning us that you know, you don't want to forget how it was when you made your failures and had your embarrassments. You want to take that into how you move ahead. And if an actor works hard and practices well, in the end, he'll begin to have a sense of satisfaction.
そしてトニーはこの失敗を乗り越えるための心身の記憶を刻み込み、自身のスケールとし、若き自分の曲の位を知るのです。
To set your mind, you need to set your mind and body in order to surmount failure and to remember your youthful, I think we can say experiences.
私も能役者の家に生まれた以上、耳にタコができるほど何度も聞かされたんですが、もっとも私の場合、失敗が多すぎまして、どの時点を初心というのかというようなありさまではございますが。
So he says he was told again and again, I guess we say reprimanded in various ways again and again, and that he had so many failures, so many occasions, so.
ここまでですとお話は失敗に学べということで済むのですが、その後も自分に合わせた初心というものが訪れるんですが、折々の曲のとの出会い、自分の体の変化をよくよく考慮しつつ乗り越え、体に刻み込んだもののみが能役者として本当の花を咲かすことができるとゼアミは言い残しております。
So in Zayami's words that remain, we get the idea that you study your faults, You revisit that first, those first feelings, those first ways in which you did things when you were young. You consider the changes that you go through. Sayami taught that only those who know their physical possibilities will be able to, as he always talks about it, bloom. A beautiful performance on stage is said to bloom.
さらに、老後の初心という言葉に言及しています。
Finally, he'd like to talk about what Sayami said about old age, the first kind of part of old age.
どんなに世間の名簿を集めた実力ある役者も、年を追い、肉体的に衰えてきますと、花の盛りの若き役者と競い合って勝つことはなかなかできません。
So, and when I said old age, I mean playing old characters. And so he said, but being old and playing characters, excuse me. So this is about old actors, in other words. And how can they compete with the young and charming? We saw the 3-year-old, we saw the 8-year-old. We can see that's a little bit tricky. So this all, Sayami's talking about this from a very practical point of view. And he's trying to help actors who are older not, you know, work in the rivalry with younger actors.
40以降、少な少なに。50以降、何事もせぬならでは手立てなし、とされる頃合いです。せぬならではとは、舞台に出るな、ということではありません。およそも、肉体を積極的に使った押し出しの強い演技は、とても不自然だということです。
Sayami had talked about what's appropriate, in terms what actors should aim at each general, like 10-year period in their career. And so the first quote that Katayama-sensei gave us means something like, do very little after the age of 40. Meaning, don't attempt anything too complicated. And then, that's a good idea. Yeah. So, and then wait till you're 50. So the 50 is translated like this. There's probably no better principle at this age than to do nothing. But of course, Sayami means these very seriously. We have to remember that this comes from a very practical standpoint. What should you do when your body's getting old? And how can you keep going? Because the idea would be to act as long as you possibly can. How do you compete with the younger ones? So these were his words. And essentially, this doesn't mean that you shouldn't appear on stage, is what Katayama-sensei says. Although he says do nothing, that doesn't mean that you're not going to appear on stage.
もちろん、人生50年と言われた昔と、100歳の方々が元気でたくさんおられる今とでは、いささか年齢的なスケールが異なるとは思いますが、せぬならでは手立てなしと言われる、この人生最後の自分の初心について、枯れた肉体に似つかわしい風体を工夫し尽くして刻み込み、またそれを忘れぬこと。そうすれば、まれに老山の花を咲かすこともあると言い残しています。
So the gist of this is that when someone is 50, when Sayami was talking about someone at 50, it's not quite the 50 we have now. Life expectancy was much shorter. But in general, he's talking about keeping that sense of freshness all the way through as you go along, and using your deteriorating body as a kind, using it. In other words, thinking about what it can do and what could be interesting with its possibilities. And then if you do that, this flower I said, the beauty and performance, you know, a kind of rare flower will bloom.
今、私の父は83歳。ひょっとするともう世阿弥の想定外の年齢ですが、いまだ現役で能を演じております。
He says that his father is now 83, and perhaps beyond life expectations, of course, that Xiaomi would have talked about, but still performing them.
しかし、一番一番、これが最後になるかもと覚悟しながら工夫を重ねております。
However, with each performance, each play that he performs, he does it with the realization that it could be the last time that he would do that. And so he tries to make use of that knowledge, keeps that in his mind as he's doing it.
しかし、面白いことに、体の効かなくなった今だからこそ発見できる、発見する手立てがあるようで、折に触れて私につぶやきます。もっとも本人は発見ってなもんやない。ほら父が申しておりますんですが、体がこういうやり方しか動かない。選択の余地がどんどんなくなっているのや。
His father has told him that it's interesting to him that as his body functions less well, he has discovered new methods. That even though his body, there's more than he's putting into his performance. And he says that you can keep discovering new things. However, he laments that his physical capabilities.
近頃私は思います。父の選択の余地のない工夫こそが私にとっての大きな発見になっているのではないかと。先人が工夫に苦しむ様を次の世代に晒し尽くしてくれている何よりの次世代への糧ではないかと。
Katayama sensei finds great sustenance in those who come before him and continue to refine their techniques in spite of the difficulties.
ゼアミは老後の初心という言葉の末尾に、命には終わりある、脳には果てあるべからずと申しております。やはり次のものが引き受けていくしかないと思います。
At the end of the discussion on the feelings for old actors, Xiaomi wrote, "Life has an ending, but no must never end." And Katayama sensei, there is only the passing on of the art.
最後になりましたが、本日このような機会を与えてくださったサンタバーバラミュージアム並びにカリフォルニア州立大学サンタバーバラ校、そして関係者の皆さんに心から御礼を申し上げ、私のスピーチとさせていただきます。ありがとうございました。
人々を魅了してやみません。 を染め上げ、趣を深めます。そして寒さの厳しい冬、刻々と変わりゆく季節、その風土が都人の美の感覚を磨き上げてきたのです。京町屋、そこには千年という時間と都人の研ぎ澄まされた美意識と凝縮された京の暮らし、京の心が息づいているところ。京都市下京区、京都市指定有形文化財杉本家住宅があります。杉本家は商家として江戸時代より呉服商を営んでいました。現在の建物は1864年源氏の大化後、1870年明治3年に再興されました。百数十年の歴史を今に伝え残す典型的な京町屋です。茶室、路地庭を望む、
私は、京都に伝わる伝統的な建造物京町屋と、そこに残される暮らしの文化を継承することを本業としています。そして同時に料理研究家として、特に京都の家庭に伝わる伝統的な和食おばんざいについて、 後世に継承することに努めております。
So she grew up in the traditional Kyoto Matsuya, traditional Kyoto home that has been passed down with, in her family and that she is a cuisine expert and particularly the what has been cooked. She works very hard to keep this going in her own family.
私は現在国の重要文化財に指定されている杉本家住宅、先ほど映像でご覧いただいた京町屋で生まれ育ちました。杉本家住宅は日本の伝統的な木造建築で、間口が約30メートル、そして奥行きが約52メートルあります。京都市内に現存する京町屋の中では最大規模であり、土蔵、お蔵といわれるものが3棟と付属する建物数棟による構成は大棚の構えを残す意向として、外観、庭内ともに保存状態に優れています。
She, the house that her family lives in is called the Sugimoto Residence and you're seeing obviously the pictures of it here. It's a traditional Japanese construction method. It's quite large. It's, in fact, it's the largest of its kind that remains in Kyoto. There are three attached warehouse buildings that are part of it.
で、杉本家の歴史は江戸時代1743年、今から271年前に呉服商奈良屋を創業いたしました。商売は京都に本店を置いて、江戸幕府の置かれた江戸に近い都市である千葉に店舗を構えて京呉服を売る商売形態でした。当時江戸幕府に近い土地に店を持つことが商売の理想形であり、いわば大棚の条件でもありました。
So just a little about the history of her family. In 1743, they established themselves. So it's been 271 years. They established a dry goods store called the Naraya, and it sold goods made in Kyoto, and in Chiba, which is many of you may know, quite close to Edo, they established another branch of the dry goods store in which, again, they sold products from Kyoto.
で、家業は江戸時代から明治時代に最も繁栄をいたしました。昭和の初めに呉服店から百貨店に成長をしました。そして私の祖父の代まで千葉市で百貨店を経営していましたけれども、1992年平成4年に財団法人を設立しまして、先祖の遺産を残す法人運営にいわば家業替えをした格好で現在に至っています。
So the business was, so they were in business from the Edo period, as I said before, mid-18th century until Meiji. Then in 1926, the dry goods store, so-called, turned into a department store. And her grandfather was the kind of representative in the Chiba branch and carried on the business. And then in 1992, the business had closed there. They incorporated as a foundation, and so that the legacy of the family home and the family business, she says, we changed our business, but that somehow she'll be able to keep it going.
さて、先祖が創業して店を発展させた江戸時代、日本では士農工商と呼ばれる身分制度が敷かれました。士は支配階級の侍、農は農民、工は工業に携わる職人、商は商業に携わる商人を表します。 杉本家は呉服商であり、身分としては四民の中では最も低い身分でした。杉本家の代々の先祖たちは商人として身分相応な暮らしをすることを心がけて生きてまいりました。
So Sugimoto sensei has explained to us that in the Edo period there was a system of four classes. You have the samurai at the top who are ruling, then the farmers, then the artisans or craftsmen, and finally at the bottom are the merchants. And of course that was their family running the dry goods store. So she said, you know, that their position was at the lowest end, the lowest strata of society, but that they strive to live in a way that was suitable to their station.
で、そうした商人の暮らしぶりが杉本家に残されている古文書の一つ、最中覚えに書き綴られています。最中覚えは一年中の行事、日々の暮らしの決まり事を月順に時系列で綴った備忘録です。
So this is a very special notebook that her family has that has been kept in the family. She calls it the 最中覚え, that's what that says there. It is called, I should say. In which daily life has been recorded. Excuse me, I should also say by month, month by month. It's organized by month.
で、最中覚えのような暮らしの備忘録は当家に限ったことではなく、江戸時代の商家では晴れの日、祝い事など非日常の行事のしつらえ、献立をはじめ、家の日、日常の献立といった日々の暮らしについてを書き残し、万事怠りなく過ごせるように代々伝えるという習慣がありました。
So in this notebook, the recorded what to do on everyday kind of meat for meals and other kinds of things, and what to do for special festival kinds of days. And she says that everything is recorded very carefully so as not to be careless or negligent of something important.
で、最中覚えは1790年、完成2年に書かれました。書き始められました。そしてこの2年前、1788年、天明の大火によって家を焼失したと考えられます。その後、復興の志を新たに書かれたものというふうに思われます。
It was first started by the second generation, and then there was a big fire in which the house burned down, and then it was started again.
そして、現存するこの最中覚えは、天保12年に書き改められたものです。この年には12代将軍家慶の下で老中水野忠邦が店舗の改革に着手をしました。この改革は質素契約の励行、風俗の取り締まりなど享保官制の改革を手本として、経済世相の引き締めに力が入れられました。
She talks about in the mid-19th century, it was rewritten, and then just talks about how during the late 18th century and then in the 19th century there were various government reforms which required people to become much more frugal and economize in various ways, and the book reflects that.
京都の商人を取り巻く環境は厳しいものでありましたけれども、奈良屋は順調に成長し、その成果が現存する杉本家住宅になったと言えるかと思います。
So you can understand from it the various circumstances surrounding what merchant families and about the family business.
私はその杉本家の10代目を継ぐ立場であり、270年にわたって先祖が残した遺産を後世に継承する役目を担うことになりました。
She personally is the 10th generation to inherit this and feels a great responsibility to carrying on these traditions.
最中覚えには毎日の食の習わしについての決まりが記されています。その質素な内容には豊かになりすぎた現代の日本人に対する戒めとも受け取れるメッセージが込められているように私には思います。これが日本の宝物なんです。
And she says that the notebook recording, of course, sort of rules and etiquette for the various traditional events, And that frugality is a very important thing. And that today's Japanese who really kind of overdo everything, a little too extravagant, you might say. It's a kind of exhortation to them to a different way, or a different way of life. And she feels that this is a kind of jewel of Japanese culture.
具体的に言うならば、京商人の家庭で作られてきたおかず、おばんざいの精神性がここに語られているのです。それを表す言葉がもったいないです。
So, and she says that the merchant families, created this kind of cuisine called おばんざい。And that there's a kind of, spiritual nature to it as well. And she's summing all of this up in a word, もったいない。
もったいないというのは仏教用語のもったいを否定する言葉で、物の本来あるべき姿がなくなるのを惜しみ嘆く気持ちを表しています。京都人にとってはもったいないという言葉は暮らしの基本的な姿勢を表し、京都では現代でも頻繁に使われている言葉なんです。
So, もったいない comes from a Buddhist word originally meaning something like the denial of、We should get Fabio to do this for us, but denial of too much, I guess we could say. I'm sure he would have an objection to that. But it deals with the pain of human existence, I guess we could say. And that Kyoto people, this is a really important word. It's a very kind of fundamental attitude that they have. And you hear it even today very frequently.
で、またこのもったいないという言葉は、環境分野で初めてのノーベル平和賞を受賞したケニア人女性ワンガリ・マータイさんが2005年の来日の時に感銘を受けて、彼女によって世界共通の言葉として地球環境を守るエコの精神を表す象徴的な言葉ともなっています。
The Kenyan who won the Nobel Peace Prizenamed Wangari Muta Maatai, came to Japan in 2005, and she was very struck by this word and its various implications.
Reduce, reuse, recycle という環境活動の 3R をたった一言で表せるだけではなく、かけがえのない地球資源に対するリスペクトが込められている言葉として、マータイさんはこの美しい日本語を環境を守る世界共通語もったいないとして広めることを提唱しました。
And you heard reduce, reuse, recycle, and she adds in this word of respect for what surrounds us, and that this word of もったいない advocates。
日本語もったいないが今世界をつなぐ合言葉もったいないになっているんですね。
It's a good word for all of us.
で、昨年12月、和食日本人の伝統的な食文化が、ユネスコ世界無形遺産に登録されました。皆さんご存知でしょうか。
She says you may all have heard thatLast year in December, UNESCO registered Japanese cooking as a world heritage.
このニュース聞かれましたでしょうか。皆さんご存知でしょうか。
And she was also, she says, she assumes maybe you know that. I would just add that Sugimoto sensei was on TV and radio and newspapers because of her stature in the world of traditional Japanese cooking. When that happened, she was very much in demand.
で、このことは、和食文化の源流である京都において発達してきた料理文化は、専門店の京懐石に代表される、美しい京料理のみならず、庶民が日常的に作り出してきたおかずおばんざいも、各部からざる食文化の一つであることを認識させてくれるものだったんです。
Well, she's showing you a particular dish from a particular Kyoto style dish from a particular establishment, just giving the idea that it's based on the kind of side dishes that an average Kyoto family would have with their rice for a meal.
で、この写真は料理屋ですね。店でお金を払って食べる料理。
This is where, I mean, you could go to a restaurant and have
でこちらが家庭料理のおばんざいです。
But then this is what you could have at home. In other words,
見た目もすごく色が茶色くて地味なあの料理がおばんざいの象徴なんです、
ね。And just from the color, you can see it's not a flashy kind of thing, but maybe we would call it comfort food.
でこの色は主には醤油で出来上がってくる料理の色です。今回私は、京都の呉服商家に伝わる和食の精神、おばんざいともったいないと題しまして、サンタバーバラ港で、明日1月30日に、お料理のデモンストレーションと、あさって31日に、講義レクチャーを、行います。
She's just letting you know what she'll be doing at UCSB in the next 2 days. Demonstration tomorrow, and a much fuller version of what you're seeing here, more focused on the notebook and some of its contents.
で、明日のデモンストレーションでは、和食の最大の特徴である出汁、スープですね、について、作り方のご紹介、試食を、する予定です。
She's going to be talking about the preparation of the basic stock for soup and
日本の、伝統的な、食文化と、家庭に共通、継承される、和食文化の素晴らしさをご理解いただく機会となることを、願います、そして同時に、日米の、何より、このサンタバーバラと日本京都の親善のさらなる深まりの礎になればというふうに思っています。
Friendship between Japan and Santa Barbara.
最後になりましたけれども、今夜のこのレセプション会場をご提供くださいましたサンタバーバラ美術館、そしてキュレーターのスーザン・タイ様をはじめ美術館関係者の皆様に深く感謝いたします。ありがとうございます。
She's thanking Susan for arranging this.
そして今回このような機会を与えてくださった東アジア言語文化学科、デイビッド・マーシャル学科長様、そして、キャサリン、サウツマン・リー先生をはじめ、大学関係者の皆様、そして、京都造形芸術大学の、田口明子先生に心から感謝を申し上げます。
And many thanks to some of us at UCSB, David Marshall in particular, and also to 田口明子
昨年、私の国では、日本の礎とも言える、出雲 雲大社と伊勢神宮にて遷宮が行われました。遷宮とは神殿を新築、収蔵するためにご神体を移すことを言います。
Last year in Japan, two important ceremonies were performed and took place, one at the Izumo Grand Shrine and the other at the Imperial Shrine of Ise. And the ceremonies were the ritual rebuilding of these shrines, and the ceremonies also involved the transfer of the gods from the old building to the new one.
神様のお住まいを常に美しく保つことで、その威力が活性し、豊かで幸福な世が続くこととされます。
These rituals are performed in order to preserve the beauty of the residences of the gods, and it is believed that by doing this, the power of the gods would be revitalized, and also this will ensure the happiness and the prosperity in this world.
出雲大社と伊勢神宮の遷宮が同年に重なるのは1300年続く遷宮の歴史においてもたった2度目の奇跡的な出来事でした。
Now this ritual rebuilding of both 出雲 shrine and 伊勢 shrine have taken place in the same year only twice in their long history of 13 centuries. So for me this is kind of a miraculous story.
私はこれを偶然ではなく必然と捉えました。
So I really thought that this was not an accident, but a necessity.
3年前、私たちの国は大きな地震に見舞われ、死者、行方不明者が 18,524 人という未曾有の被害を受けました。
Now, 3 years ago, as you all know, Japan was struck by a huge earthquake. It was an unprecedented disaster that took more than 18,000 lives.
被害の大きさは世界を驚愕させましたが、同時に、大切な家庭、家族を失い、家や職場を失う人々が身を寄せながら、わずかに残ったものを奪い合うのではなく、分かち合い、助け合う姿に驚きを感じたことと思います。
Now, at the time, the entire world was appalled by the magnitude of this disaster, but at the same time, peopleall around the world were also surprised that the Japanese affected by the disasters, those who had lost their family, their houses, their jobs, instead of fighting each other to grab whatever was left, they rather shared what they found and helped each other.
ところが、この精神性は日本人だけではなく、全人類が共通できるアニミズムに通底しているのです。私はそこに世界平和と環境保護を実現するヒントが含まれていることを知り、遷宮作品集神の宮を通じ全世界に訴えたいと思いました。
Personally, I think that this kind of spiritual attitude shown by the Japanese of the time, is not only typical of the Japanese people, but is kind of common to the entire humankind.As a deep manifestation of animism. And I believe that in this animistic attitude, one can find a hint on how to ensure world peace and environmental protection. So I decided to show an example of this animistic attitude in the ritual.Rebuilding of the shrines, and I decided to cover Izumo and Ise in this exhibition, which I call the residences of the gods.
神の宮で伝えたいもの、それは実際に目に見えている神殿やその奥にある先祖からのメッセージなのです。
So in this exhibition, in the Kaminomiya, in the residences of the gods, what I would like to convey to all of you is not the visible rituals and the buildings, but rather a deeper message from our ancestors that lie behind the visible forms.
古来、私たちが継承してきた精神文化である遷宮は、自然に感謝し、万物と調和する心、生命を育み合う新しい世代につなげる英知が含まれているのです。
Now this ritual rebuilding of the shrines, which has been handed down to us from past generations as an important part of the Japanese spiritual culture, is an expression of gratitude toward nature and a celebration of harmony with the cosmos, and at the same time is a means to transmit wisdom from the past to the future generations.
そのことをぜひ皆様と共に新しい世代を幸福なものにしたいと願っております。
And I would like to share this wisdom with all of you in the hope that it can be transmitted to the future generations.
最後になりましたが、東北大震災の際、帰国の温かいご支援と救援活動に従事していただいた皆様に深く感謝申し上げます。
And I would also like to thank to show my deep gratitude.To the American people for all the help given to Japan after the great earthquake of 3 years ago.
また、このような機会を与えてくださったカリフォルニア州大学サンタバーバラ校、サンタバーバラミュージアム、関係者の皆様、そしてサンタバーバラジャパン写真グループ代表、福留健治氏およびボランティアの皆様に深く感謝申し上げます。
Finally, I would like to thank everyone involved in the realization of this event, in particular the University of California Santa Barbara, the Santa Barbara Museum of Art, everyone involved in the organization, and also the Santa Barbara Japan Photography Group, and in particular his representative, Mr. Kutome, and all the volunteers who participated in this event.
それでは、神の宮の映像をご覧ください。どうもありがとうございました。
Okay, now I would like to show you a video based on the exhibition directed to you.
Thank you. Into another world.
And when the music begins, I will ask you quietly turn your head towards the back of this room, of our auditorium, because Mr. Kageyama is using the long bridge coming in at that moment. So I'm gonna do something up here.
パンパンパン。